Started here. And welcome all of you to our panel on stories of rebellion and revolutionary history. So I'm really excited to be moderating this panel. I'm fascinated by the subject of revolution. And I think in our sort of resist moment, studying revolution, thinking about it is really important. Next semester I'm teaching a class on protest traditions in American history, and I think the stories of revolution are really critical and necessary because I think they do two main things. One, they show us how to name power, and they show us possibility, because power is that thing that's always sort of around and never speaks its own name. And so stories that try to investigate power help us see it and name it, both in its oppressive forms and in potentially liberatory forms. And they also show us the world of possibility, how people can stand up to power and can imagine other possible worlds. I think that's also really critical. So I'm really excited to be opening this panel for all of you, and I'm going to now stop speaking about myself and start speaking about our excellent panelists. Our first speaker is going to be Elnaya Kendrick. She's at the sophomore level. She's an accounting major. She's involved in Students Today, Alumni Tomorrow, the Business Leadership Development Fellowship, the Woke Book Club, which I want to join. Her interests are around volunteering, learning with the African diaspora, and also collecting antiques. Her presentation is going to be on Gaspar Yenga, the first liberator of the Americas, and the impact he's had on Mexicans of African descent. Our second presenter is Raquel Battaglia. She is also at the sophomore level. She is in University Singers, in Mouthing Off, the improv troupe, in Alpha Phi Omega, the volunteer honor society. She's a psychology major and a writing minor, and her paper is going to explore the impact that cultural expectations and changing roles can have on individuals, so that individuals experience and respond to expectations and potentially rebel against those. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to have Elnaya give her presentation, and then we'll pause for a second, and Raquel will quickly give her presentation, and then I'll open the floor for discussions. Our third presenter wasn't able to make it, so we actually have either more time for a longer discussion, or we can adjourn early and have the sort of informal discussions I think we all like to have as well during towards the end of a long day of the Arts and Sciences Symposium. So I'm going to hand it off to Elnaya.
Good afternoon. So my topic is about Gaspar Yenga. He is the unsung revolutionary. Typically, when you think of slave rebellions, you think of Nat Turner. And so I want to bring attention to Gaspar Yenga. So first, I want to provide some context of slavery in Mexico. Slavery in Mexico is quite similar to slavery in different countries like Brazil, Cuba, and America. Once the indigenous people decreased in population due to illness, Mexico received more than 200,000 enslaved Africans to work on sugar plantations and silver mines. Also, the African slaves were worth four times more than indigenous people, and they were thought to have more physical stamina and endurance to work in the hot tropical climates. As well as the enslaved Africans did escape, they went to the remote areas, typically in the high mountain ranges, and Gaspar Yenga was one of them. He organized himself and other slaves to Veracruz, and they formed a settlement. Also, Mexico produced the largest free black population in the Americas. So this is Veracruz. If you want to study Afro-Mexican culture and the people, it's best to start here. Veracruz was the main entry port for cargo and enslaved Africans. A lot of uprisings occurred in or near Veracruz. You can also go to the left bottom corner of this map and go to these states to study Afro-Mexican culture as well. Also, with the Afro-Mexicans in Veracruz, a lot of outsiders have come into Veracruz, and there has been race mixing involved. So they typically don't really look black in a sense. There has been an admixture in their ancestry. But the other Afro-Mexicans in the other states, they look more black because they have been isolated from society, and also because of the mountains, it's hard to access those states. And the mountains of Veracruz served as protection for runaway African slaves and the indigenous people. So before I dive into Yanga, I want to provide a brief overview about him, and then after that I will explain in further detail.
Known as the first liberator of the Americas, Gaspar Yanga led one of the most successful slave rebellions in the Americas. During the 16th century, sugar was the main crop in Veracruz. Yanga was among the many slaves brought over from West Africa and forced into working the Spanish sugar plantations in Mexico. Around 1570, he led a slave revolt and escaped with a group of followers into the mountainous terrain surrounding Veracruz. There, Yanga and his people formed a settlement, which grew to some 550 people and eluded capture for nearly 30 years. This thriving community became a beacon of freedom for other runaway slaves. Yanga and his people survived through agriculture and livestock. They also waged a campaign against Spanish colonial rule on raiding caravans that ran between Veracruz and Mexico City, carrying goods, food, and other supplies. Yanga's raids and the ongoing exodus of black and indigenous slaves to his community upset the Spanish plantation owners. The owners called on the colonial government to take action. In 1609, the Spanish governor sent a military force of 500 men to put an end to Yanga and his group. Opposing that force was Yanga's irregular army armed with firearms, machetes, bows and arrows, and even stones. When Yanga learned of the impending attack, he sent one of his Spanish prisoners to negotiate peace terms. The Spanish, however, had no interest in negotiation, and a brutal battle quickly ensued. Both sides suffered heavy casualties, but the Spanish governor was forced to respect Yanga's strength. Yanga and his survivors retreated higher up into the mountains, out of Spanish reach, and again flourished. After many failed negotiations and military actions, the Spanish opted to negotiate in 1618. Under a treaty, Spain granted freedom to Yanga and his followers in exchange for an end to raids on Spanish caravans. In addition, the former slaves were given land, and Yanga and his family were recognized as the rulers of the community. By 1630, the town of San Lorenzo de los Negros was born, the first free African settlement in the Americas. In 1932, the town was renamed Yanga, to honor the courageous man who represented hope and liberty to so many enslaved people. Yanga's courage in the face of danger inspires us all to stand up for our beliefs and freedom. And we are honored to call him a hero of color.
So the first settlement that he organized was about 80 men. It also consisted of 24 women. There were 60 huts and, of course, children. It lasted about for 9 months, and there was a small church on site. As the video mentioned, they thrive on agriculture and farming. These are some of the items they planted. 40 of the men attended to crops and cattle, while the other 40 were in the army. Yanga was in charge of civil administration, and he assigned Francisco to be in charge of the army. Also, the settlement included a Spaniard captive, and Yanga told his Spaniard captive, "Do not fear, Spaniard, for you have seen my face, and so you cannot die." He has also been described as, "This Yanga was a Negro of the Bron Nation, of whom it is said that if they had not captured him, he would have been king in his own land. He had been the first Maroon to flee his master, and for 30 years had gone free in the mountains, and he has united others who held him as chief." And so with the rebellion, so the Spaniard captive was ordered by Yanga to write a letter to the captain of the Spanish army to defeat him. And so the captain found the settlement and a battle broke out. Both sides lost a huge number of people. And then Hera, the captain, he reached the top of the settlement and realized that Yanga had moved him and his people to another location, which I will show you on the next slide. And then the captain received a second note from Yanga stating his defiance and unwillingness to make peace. So as you can see, that over there on the right side is the first settlement. And then the hideout is where Yanga moved him and his followers to pretty much hide themselves from the Spaniards. And after failing multiple times to conquer Yanga, the Spaniards did not have a choice but to surrender. Now, to mention, the Spaniards were trained in military. They had advanced weapons, and Yanga and his army, they were not quite trained, and they only had stones, rocks, machetes to defend themselves. But the Spaniards, they just had to surrender. Yanga was too strong for them. And so they also needed Yanga and his army to capture the other fugitive slaves in the area. And part of the agreement was to stop raiding and helping slaves escape and to return them back to their slave owners. Because at this time, the Africans outnumbered the slave owners in Mexico. And so there were rumors of uprisings and the slave owners were in fear. So the proposal that Yanga had with the Spaniards was that he and his people would surrender and return for land and the right to self-govern. He offered to return the slaves back to their slave owners. He wanted Irani to have his people free. The other proposal was that no other Spaniards were to live in the village. They could only visit on market days. So that means that the Spanish merchants were to only go to the village once a week, and once they were done selling their items, they had to leave. They could not return until next week. Only Franciscan priests were allowed to minister the village, and the Spanish crown were to finance the church. The town must have a council and councilmen, and the town must be between those two areas, and Yanga and his men were to be able to carry arms to defend themselves. And the final condition was that Yanga must be governor of the town, and the succession shall go to his descendants. However, there has been limited research on his descendants. Not many people know if he had children and a wife. It would be interesting to know about if any of the today's Afro-Mexicans are descendants of Yanga. I think if they were descendants of Yanga, it would be a greater supply of information about him, because the information is quite limited about his early life and personal life as well. So this is the establishment of the new settlement. Is right here. Today it's named Yanga, and as you can see, it's not too far away from the original village. So it was established in 1630, and as shown in the previous slide, it wasn't too far from the old settlement. Today you can visit Yanga, actually. Henry Louis Gates, for his series Black in Latin America, he visited Veracruz. He saw the ports where the slaves were brought to Veracruz, and you can actually see the blood of the many deaths of the slaves. Also, with Veracruz, you can talk to the locals about Yanga. They actually have a carnival, which I'll mention later. They have a carnival, and it celebrates the history of Yanga, the legacy as well. And so the impact that Yanga has had on today's Afro-Mexican population is that today they are still fighting for recognition, as well as they want to bring awareness to the fact that there are Afro-Mexicans. They have been invisible. The Mexican government just recently recognized them back in 2015, actually. But there's about 1.2% of them, sorry. And in 2020, they will officially be recognized in Mexico. They'll be included in the census. And so there's actually a organization. It was founded in 1997. In English, it's Mexican Black Civic Association. They want to seek recognition. They want to promote development of the communities. They want to rescue their culture. They want to fight discrimination and work with the government to eliminate invisibility of blacks in Mexico. They've also been very active in different events around the world. Back in 1999, they went to Venezuela and they participated in the reunion of blacks. They also went to Bahia, Brazil. Bahia, Brazil is about 80% black, and they connected with the Afro-Brazilians there. They've also done some work with African-Americans. And so this is the carnival. The indigenous and blacks, they come together and they celebrate Yanga. They also celebrate the African roots of Mexico. Usually the African roots in Mexico are ignored, and they want to bring awareness to the African roots. And so here's the statue of Yanga. You can actually visit Veracruz and see the statue. And also Henry Louis Gates, he visited that statue, and the placement of it is kind of weird. Across from the statue is like an old basketball court. I think it's kind of a weird placement to have a statue of a hero. And so to end, I want to end with this fact. In 1871, he was designated as the National Hero of Mexico and the first liberator of the Americas.
For you, if you want, we can do some questions now, and then we can break for questions for everybody at the end.
Okay. Yeah, let's ask some. So
stay up there, Alnaya.
Okay.
I think there are any questions for Alnaya. Hmm?
Yeah, what led you to this particular field of study and this particular individual?
Yeah, so I was just like researching, and I came across this article about the Afro-Mexicans finally being recognized, and I was like, Afro-Mexicans. Interesting. I never heard of Afro-Mexicans. Like, I've heard of like other Afro-Latinos, like Afro-Cubans.
Right.
Yeah, and I'm like, Afro-Mexicans, interesting. So I read the article, and then I did further research, and I was very amazed at how they have been hidden.
Mm-hmm.
And so I also ran into Gaspar Yanga, and I started studying him, and I was quite surprised at how he isn't really recognized in terms of like slave rebellions, usually the hero of Nat Turner. But with Yanga, his rebellion was successful. And so that's how I got into Afro-Mexican history and Yanga.
Is he taught in Mexico?
Okay, so the textbooks in Mexico, they don't really include the black history, unfortunately. But if you go to Veracruz or like the other states and you ask the locals about Yanga, they will tell you. Some of them won't know. It just depends on if they're aware.
Mm-hmm.
But outside of the Afro-Mexican communities, the general Mexican population doesn't have a clue about the Afro-Mexican population, which is what the organization is fighting for. They want recognition.
Yeah,
thank you.
As part of his negotiation, you said that slaves were returned to their owners.
Yeah.
Wasn't that the population of his community, though? Wouldn't he wipe out his own?
Oh yeah, so the population of his community, they were free. But the slaves that he had that weren't free, he only did that just to pretty much ease the worries of the slave owners.
Mm-hmm.
And also, if he returned the slaves back to the slave owners, he were to be paid, so.
And do you have any feeling after your work about the state of discrimination in Mexico versus the U.S.?
I've actually made some connections with, like, the discrimination between blacks in Mexico and blacks in America. The only difference is that like with African Americans, we're able to go to university, we're able to advance in society. With Mexico's not, with Afro-Mexicans, not too much. They're generally really poor. They have a lack of infrastructure in their communities, poor healthcare. Actually, for me, in the future, I want to go to Veracruz and help them and help set up nonprofits to, you know, help them advance in society. But the connections that I made was that, of course, there's discrimination. usually with the media, they are pretty much portrayed as like criminals, or with the TV shows, the only jobs they have on TV is to be like a slave or maid. That's the connections I've made with Blacks in Mexico and Blacks in America.
Thank you.
I'm not sure remembering this right, but did you say 1932 is the year that the town is named Yanga? Is that the year that happens?
Yes.
So do you know why? What's happening that the town is renamed that year?
Yeah, so they renamed the town Yanga.
Mm-hmm.
So there's this historian. He discovered some archives of Yanga. He discovered the settlements and the treaty. And so he wrote different journals and papers about Yanga. And so that's how some of the, I guess you can say, like, curiosity began with Yanga. And so from there, people were aware of like Yanga and like the African history, the slavery. And so they renamed it Yanga to celebrate and honor him.
Thank you, Amaya. So our next speaker is Raquel De Padilla, and I will. Do you need to mute the screen? Or you
don't? I'm not going to.
Okay.
Can I just turn it off, or should I just leave it?
I think you should go get set up, and if I successfully turn this off, we won't clap. We'll just continue to look at you.
All right. Well, hello, everyone. I'm Raquel Battaglia. Today I'm speaking a little bit less about revolution in a grand sense and a little bit more on like a personal level. I try to focus on, I use two different people, a fictional one and one from history, and speak about how when they were faced with either their role in life changing or when the perception of their role in life was changed by their culture, how they responded to that and the consequences of their response. During our lifetimes as individuals, our roles in society's expectations of us change. We are sisters, students, mentors, uncles, employees, and each role carries with it its own set of expectations. These expectations can stand in conflict with our own self-expectations, and when this happens, we are faced with a choice. We can either accept this change or fight, rebel against it. Change in our environments is inevitable, but how we react to this change is our own choice and can have a massive impact on our development of ourselves. Today, I will be using Shakespeare's King Lear and history's Joan of Arc as examples of individuals whose reactions to environments that challenged themselves had far-reaching consequences. Joan stands as a unique example because her role as a military savior was utterly unexpected. Joan was female, illiterate, and raised in poverty. In the countryside of 15th century France, she was expected by both her family and society at large to get married, raise children, and remain within her impoverished social class. This was not what Joan expected of herself. Joan saw herself as a divinely appointed military commander. Joan believed that she had a divine mission from God to protect France from the rebelling Burgundians who were in allegiance with England. Transitioning from her role as a peasant woman to a knight was an uphill battle against her society's expectations. When Joan's self and environment were in such conflict, she changed how she presented herself to the world, and this forced her environment to adapt to her. When Joan's parents arranged for her to be married, she ran away from home to preserve her independence and virginity. This was the moment that Joan ran away to the world, not from the world, as a biography by Warner writes. She could have hidden away from society, but instead she flung herself straight at it. Prompted by voices that only she could hear, voices she believed belonged to the Archangel Michael and the saints Catherine and Margaret, Joan sought the Dauphin, a French leader. When she found him, legend says that she was able to immediately recognize him in the crowd of courtiers, despite having never seen a portrait of him. Addressing him with a tempestuous heart, a dramatic nature, and passionate conviction, Joan told the Dauphin that she was sent from God to assist in crowning him the King of France and to ensure that the Burgundians were driven away from them. According to legend, Joan also showed Dauphin a miraculous sign, a mystical crown, and he was convinced that she was the savior of the country that they had been waiting for. He granted her control of a small army and gave her his blessing. A little country girl, still in her teens, now had the approval of one of the most powerful men in France and a small military force to call her own. Through her passion, Joan had shifted the expectations placed upon her. A biographer writes, Joan was the personification of mobility. She accepted neither her peasant birth nor her female condition. None of the limitations society had provided for her circumspection. Women of Joan's era were not given any autonomy in making decisions about their livelihoods. Their lives were governed by their families, originally by their parents and later by their husbands. Joan, acting as an individual, following after what she believed God had called her to do, was dynamically opposed to culture's expectations. With society changing its perception of her and placing new expectations on her to be the military savior from God, Joan changed her appearance to encourage this perception. Instead of dressing as a rural woman, Joan began dressing as a chivalrous knight. In her culture, knights had the position of determining right from wrong. By posing as a knight, Joan was making a statement that she not only had the autonomy to make her own decisions, but that her decisions were valid to others outside of herself as well. Knighthood was also a solely male profession, and her adoption of their dress was a radical decision. Joan was claiming to be as powerful as a man. In her culture, nobility was a trait someone was born with. It could be neither earned nor achieved except through right of birth. Social relevance was given at birth and not gained through work, but she showed that she did not have to be born a noblewoman to be a noble. Her extreme transition had a polarizing effect on those around her, particularly among the elite of society. Some were willing to accept her deep subversion of society's organization because of her perceived divine appointment, but many opposed her dramatic defiance of societal structure. For then, as now, a society feels stable when neither institutions nor people shift or change. Joan's iconic image and legendary voices caused her enemies to view her as a dangerous religious heretic. The same image and voices caused those who love her to paint her as a living saint. Though Joan rejected being treated as a saint, she refused to attempt healings and rebuked those who tried to worship her. The holy image stuck to her regardless. In a male-dominated society, the only women in her culture who had ever achieved greatness were those who had achieved it through religious piety. People had no way to conceive of her as someone powerful without also attributing to her sainthood. The possibility of a military leader was too foreign for even those who loved her to embrace. Even though she had been accepted by society as a hero, Joan could never be accepted as the brand of hero with which she saw herself. Despite pockets of opposition and being pigeonholed as a religious zealot, Joan continued to dress and behave as a knight, and her military following grew. Noblemen sent her soldiers and supplies, and she was blessed with a grand series of victories. Joan was starting to break from the image of a living saint into a divine general. Unfortunately, after her initial success and idealization, she hit upon a series of losses that fated her for destruction. On a day celebrating Virgin Mary's birthday, September 8th, Joan ignored a truce that had been established by the King of France and attempted to drive the Burgundians out of the city of Paris. The siege was a costly failure. Joan was wounded physically, but the danger the failure posed to her reputation proved to be the most dangerous injury by far. The failure marked the countdown to her capture 7 months later. Several small defeats followed this defeat at Paris, and Joan lost the people's support. When she had been undefeated, she had been accepted as God's heroine, but it was considered impossible for a person on a divine mission to experience failure. Many now rejected the idea that Joan had divine inspiration, and instead saw her as a heretic and a witch, spreading lies about the will of God. The attitude of society had shifted against Joan. With support for her ever-shrinking army waning, Joan went into battle for the last time on May 24, 1430. As the battle began to fail, Joan ordered a retreat back to the fort that was the stronghold. Joan, who had been leading the army, was the last soldier to make it back to the castle. When she arrived, she found the gate closed and the drawbridge raised. She had not been considered valuable enough to leave the gate open for and run the risk of enemies entering the castle. Locked outside, Joan was pulled from her horse by her coattails by a Burgundian archer. even in the hands of her sworn enemies, Joan's passionate conviction to her purpose never waned. Several months after her capture, Joan learned she was being ransomed to the British. When learning of this, Joan attempted suicide by jumping out of a window of her prison. She said that she would rather surrender her soul to God than be given to the enemies of her beloved France. Joan would rather die than have her autonomy and her life purpose taken away from her. This was her devotion to herself. The British put Joan on trial for heresy, believing she was a witch. The entire trial was an attack on Joan's identity, but no matter how strong the opposition, Joan refused to adapt herself to accommodate. The British court sought to prove that she was a witch using black magic to fake heavenly appointment. They claimed that her voices were demons, her male dress an affront to God, and her suicide attempt was actually an attempt to fly using witchcraft. Throughout her trial, Joan remained staunch in her stance that she was a true follower of God and had been sent on a mission by him. She was true to her purpose. However, here in a courtroom, her background as an illiterate peasant severely disabled her ability to defend herself. Her prior power of magnetism had come not from expansive vocabulary, but from the passion and conviction that colored her simple words. This had been enough to acquire the Dauphin's support and an army, but no amount of passion was enough to outdo the wit and determination of her prosecutors. After a year of exhausting interrogations, Joan was condemned as a heretic and burned at the stake. In a biography of Joan's life, the author writes that her martyrdom was a consummation of her unbending trueness to herself. By staying true to herself, Joan stood strong until her death. However, such an unbending attitude to change is not always the most beneficial option. Lear, from Shakespeare's play King Lear, shows the counterside to maintaining an unyielding attitude. By refusing to accept his changing role in society, Lear loses his family, his sanity, and in the end, his life. The story starts with Lear growing old. He decides to retire and bestow his kingdom upon his three daughters in accordance with their professions of love. His first two daughters, Regan and Gonerhim, flatter him, and he gives them generous portions of his kingdom. His third daughter, Cordelia, refrains from flattery and says simply, "I love your majesty, according to my bond, no more, no less." Flying into a rage, King Lear disowns Cordelia and banishes her from his kingdom. Lear's lifelong friend and right-hand man, Kent, rises to defend Cordelia, begging the king to see better. Lear directs his anger towards him and banishes him as well, on threat of death. Lear responds to Cordelia and Kent in this aggressive and extreme way because Cordelia's apparent flippancy and Kent's defiance challenge Lear's authority as king. At his core, King Lear saw himself as a king, not as a father or as a friend. Because of this, Lear defends his right to adoration and flattery, even if it means forgoing his duties as father and friend. Before this moment, there are signs in the play that Lear has been able to fulfill the roles of both father and king, just as society expects him to. His eldest two daughters both have wealthy husbands, and Cordelia has two powerful beaux. He's been successful in matching them. His kingdom is not at war, and it is large enough to be split three ways. It appears he has been successful. Lear's downfall begins when he has to choose between his role as King of England and his role as father or friend. The expectations of the role he was to play shifted, and he did not shift along with them. Lear's rejection of his family role is imitated by his daughters. Following in their father's footsteps, Regan and Goneril also chose power over family when one must be prioritized over the other. After Lear gives land and power to his daughters, he plans to be sustained by alternating between living with Regan and Goneril with his entourage of 100 knights. However, without his power, Lear has no strength with which to back up his commands, and he is left vulnerable to abuse. When it becomes inconvenient to give room and board to their father and his followers, Regan and Goneril turn on him. They refuse to allow him to keep his knights, bully him into wandering outside in a fierce storm, and eventually plot his death. They could have overlooked the inconvenience of caring for their elderly father and showed him gratitude for all the years he had cared for them. However, this would have required having their family as their core role and top priority. It is clear both of them craved power above all else, and this led them to immense cruelty. When Lear is turned away by his daughter Goneril, he laments, "Ingratitude, thou marble-hearted fiend, more hideous when thou showest thee in a child than in the sea monster." Lear has transitioned from an independent king to a dependent father, but he is blind to this shift and refuses to admit that he has lost his kingly authority. By having unhealthy priorities, Lear has poisoned the dynamics of his entire family. Our responses to our changing environments affect not only ourselves, but those around us as well. Rejected by his daughters, Lear finds himself clutching at a shadow of his past self. When he laments to his fool that he does not know who he has become, the fool tells Lear that he has become Lear's shadow. Lear has been diminished until he is only a fragment, diminished of who he used to be, able only to look up at the full body of Lear and see himself for who he actually is. His old role has been torn from him, and he's refused to adopt a new role. This has left him floundering. When Lear, still clinging to his illusion of kingship, is locked outside during the storm, he tries to maintain his sense of authority by commanding himself to not weep. "I have full cause of weeping, but this cause shall break into 100,000 flaws ere all weep. O fool, I shall go mad." His friend the fool tries to coax Lear to take shelter, but Lear still tries to cling to his kingly strength and attempts to command the storm, since he has nothing else to command. Despite witnessing the damage caused by his daughters clinging to power over family, Lear remains bound to his core of kingship instead of relenting and seeking out his friend Lear or loving daughter Cordelia. Lear is responding to challenging environments by falling into a role that is no longer his to claim. In the midst of the storm, Lear finally realizes he is no longer king. Because this is the core of his personality, this loss, coupled with the physical assault of this storm, breaks Lear's sanity. By refusing to adapt himself to accommodate new situations, Lear loses his self entirely. In his madness, Lear constructs himself a crown of thistles and weeds. This represents that his kingship had deteriorated into a laughable shadow of his former glory, and clinging to it brings him shame rather than glory. Instead of being strengthened in adversity, as Joan was, Lear was brought to his knees. After her banishment, Cordelia married the King of France and moved to Dover. When she hears of her sister's treachery, she sends out a search party to look for her beloved father. They find him wandering about the moors in lunacy and capture him. On the return to Dover, Lear passes out from exhaustion and from exposure to the elements. Upon arriving in Dover, the doctor changes Lear out of the rags and crown of weeds he has formed himself in his lunacy. Cordelia kisses his forehead and embraces him, waking Lear. Upon realizing his daughter Cordelia is present, Lear gets up from his bed and bows before her, professing that he is a very foolish old man, not in my perfect mind. This moment is deeply symbolic. Lear has been stripped of every crown, even the dilapidated crown of weeds, and now bows before his daughter, something that a king would never do. By bowing to his family, Lear is demonstrating that he has finally shed his old identity and is surrendering to his family. Lear tells Cordelia that, "I know you do not love me, for your sisters have done me wrong. You have some cause, and they do not." Cordelia begs him to stand, ensuring him that her love for him is as deep as it was before their conflict, and embraces him. Lear finally weeps, something he swore he would never do when he was still clinging to his illusion of power. Lear has finally allowed his core role to change, to accommodate his change in circumstances, and with this allowance, his sanity is restored. Shortly after the reunion, Lear and Cordelia are captured by Edgar, a power-hungry bastard. Edgar sends assassins to kill Cordelia and Lear, but Edgar is killed by his kind-hearted brother Edward, who then sends servants to save Lear and Cordelia. The servants arrive too late to save Cordelia, who is hanged in front of her father. Lear kills the murderer and is found carrying Cordelia's body, lamenting that, "I might have saved her. Now she's gone forever." With his only true daughter torn from here, Lear has lost yet another core role. Losing his core of kingship had resulted in Lear losing his sanity. Losing his fatherhood destroys him entirely. Mere minutes after Cordelia's death, Lear collapses in grief, never to rise again. Both Joan and Lear face circumstances that pose as profound challenges to their core roles. both staunchly resist relinquishing their roles, which cost Joan her life and Lear his sanity and his life. When someone is placed into a situation that is incompatible with who they are at their core, they face a challenging dilemma. The core of an individual is an incredibly potent attribute. It serves as the lens that the person sees the world through and determines their attitude towards other people and situations. To change it is to change an individual's entire perspective on life. But to resist change can mean to live in an environment that is incompatible with oneself. When faced with such ultimatums, the challenged individual should look within themselves to determine whether it is appropriate to cling to their core or to release themselves to embrace a new perspective. People cannot avoid the influence of their environment, but they can choose how they respond to such an environment. Thank you.
Questions?
Yana.
Okay, so this is pertaining to Joan of Arc's struggle with her own interests as in opposition to those of society. Okay, so she was burned at the stake at age 19 or whatnot, but then years later she was proclaimed a martyr, meaning that societal perspective or had to have been modified or altered somehow. Like, what do you think, you know, like, because, you know, originally they deemed her a heathen, a heretic, uneducated peasant, whatnot. So what do you think led to that shift in perspective?
Well, I think hindsight is a truly powerful thing, because when you're past something, you can kind of look it back and you can see it in the face and see it for what it is. And so I feel like there's a lot of political dynamics that were involved in Joan being sent back to the English. Like the French sold their heroine to the English, essentially. And I especially believe that after some of the witch hunting kind of crazed mania kind of passed through society, kind of has come and go through waves through a lot of cultures, that people were able to recognize that she was not a witch, that that kind of superstition should not have had a place in the judgment upon her. And I believe that also after England and France were no longer in like their 100-year battle, and after they were able to come to some peace with each other, and that animosity had faded away, France was no longer afraid to claim her as the savior that she had been for them. She had held some significant battle successes. So I think a lot of it was the culture changing away from superstition and the peace that eventually came between France and England. Yes?
I have a question. And sort of, maybe it's actually two questions. But I was thinking about, I like the way you described Lear as using his power to force everyone else to flatter him, like that's what he's doing himself as a king, like to enforce a kind of social code on everybody else,
mm-hmm.
To sort of reify the fact that he's king. But he tries to change his environment with his power. But I wonder then, isn't the person in King Lear who's more like Joan of Arc Cordelia? Right, she's the one who resists that change by saying, you know, no, what you are is my father, and I will, you know, I owe to you my duty to you as a father, not as a king who's going to demand that I flatter you.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the one part that I was thinking of. Like, is Cordelia in some ways a parallel also for Joan of Arc?
Yeah, and with that I would agree that Cordelia has many more similarities with Joan of, regardless of what happened circumstantially around her, she was always, I know this is the truth, and I will stand by it. And I chose Lear instead because I felt like he showed more of a counterpoint to that, as more of a contrast, because even though he too is in a sense clinging to a sense of self, it wasn't so much a self as Joan was a self of, this is my purpose in life. Hers was in relation to herself. His role, he wanted it in relation to other people. I want power over this, I want power over that. And kind of, I wanted to show how when you're different roles, when clung to, can have different consequences.
I mean, so it's my follow-up question. Does it matter if one is asserting or sticking to a sort of sense of self when that is, when one is in a position of not having authority, like Joan, right?
Can you rephrase the question? Sorry.
So this idea that, like, question is, do you maintain your sense of self in a changing environment, or do you sort of
choose to transform yourself as your situation changes.
Yeah, I think that's one of the things that, it, because so many different circumstances can be so different, it's really not, you can't answer it yes or no for any person. I think what was drastically a difference that I see between King Lear and Joan and how they had different results from their decisions was that for Joan to relinquish her role would have been to completely deny her values and what she wanted to see herself as. King Lear, he could have relinquished his role as a king and stood up as a father and friend and still maintained his aspects of personality of deciding, you know, as a king, your role is to protect your kingdom and make it flourish. As a friend, as a father, you know, you're trying to get your friends and your family. You want to protect them. You want them to flourish. So he, by changing his role, he wasn't necessarily having to change the basis of his personality. For Joan to have changed her role through history would have had to have been an utter denial of, oh, I was lying this whole time. I'm a witch. I'm not on a grand quest. I'm trying to deceive all of you. So I think when answering that question, it's important to realize that, well, this role change, is this simply you are maintaining yourself and you are changing the role, or well, are you changing the core of yourself? Mm-hmm. This is a slightly convoluted answer, I'm sorry.
No, it's an interesting, complicated question.
Professor Hanley.
This paper is a version of something that you wrote for a class of mine, and it's really great to hear it in this context. And I wonder, would you call Cordelia a rebel within her cultural context? Do you think what she did by saying, you know, I can only love you as a father, was a rebellious act?
It's hard. I think a lot of it depends on how you define rebellion. Like when I picture a rebel, Cordelia is definitely not like the first image that comes to mind, but that doesn't,
but
I believe that necessarily
is,
she
yeah.
wasn't. Yeah, because right. Cordelia, I feel, if she is said as a rebel, isn't a rebel to the same degree as Joan may have been, because Joan had a lot of set things that she was supposed to do, and she wouldn't do them. She was like, I'm going to dress as a man, I'm not getting married, I'm going to go be a knight.
Mm-hmm.
For Cordelia, it was, even though she was rebelling against some of the expectations that was placed upon her, she still did it while maintaining a role as, like, the expected love of a daughter for her father. So even if she may have rebelled against personal expectations of people personally placed upon her, but I don't believe she was rebelling against any wider societal expectations.
Yeah. Thanks.
Anything else? Okay. Well, thank you for listening.
So unless someone has a question that they think is going to draw these two disparate papers.